Shalom and welcome to this edition of Revealing the Truth, where we cover the headlines, the heart lines, and biblical truth. I'm your host, the Reverend Rabbi Eric Walker, and we're visiting today with Prebendary John Woolmer, who was rector of Shepton Mallet from 1982 to 2002. John, welcome to our program.
Thank you very much.
Well, you're quite welcome. John has
good to be with you.
John has authored the book, The Devil Goes Missing, Deliverance, Theology, Practice, History. He chaired the Bath and Wells Diocesan Healing Group and helped with the Deliverance Ministry from 2002 to 2007. He worked with Springboard and Resource while leading a New Expression Church in Leicester. He has written a number of books, led missions, taught about healing and deliverance in many countries, including Zambia, Tanzania, Argentina, and Papua New Guinea. John, it is just such a delight to be with you as you are live from Leicester in England with us today. John, talk about your early years, going back as far as you want to go in the beginning of this life that you led for the Lord.
Thank you very much. Well, my father had a fairly miraculous escape from Dunkirk in the war, and I was conceived fairly soon afterwards. I grew up in a sort of middle-class English household. My mother was a keen churchgoer, and I went to a boarding school in England and read mathematics at Oxford, and that was where I had a conversion experience. And lively evangelical church in Oxford city centre. I then went to teach mathematics at Winchester College, which is one of the leading schools in England, and was involved in something called the School Mathematics Project, which revolutionized secondary school maths. To my surprise, when I'd been teaching a few years, I got a very clear call to ordination. I stayed on there as a chaplain for a while. We had quite a revival. Someone you may know, Richard Harvey, who founded Jews for Jesus.
Yes.
Was converted and baptized at Winchester, and I'm still in touch with him from time to time. Then I went as curate in Oxford to someone again you may know, Canon Michael Green, who's written lots and lots of books.
Yes.
And it was there I got involved in the Deliverance Ministry, which was a complete surprise to both Michael and myself. And we had quite a lot of quite hair-raising experiences, some of which doubtless will come up in the second half. I then went to run a church in Somerset, in a town of about 8,000 people called Shepton Mallet, with a couple of small villages. And we saw a steady growth in our congregation and were very much involved in the healing ministry. And I got it more on the map in the Diocese of Bath and Wells. We had a big link with Zambia, and I led a number of teaching missions in Zambia, where we had some pretty rough experiences with the evil spirit up in the north of Zambia in the Luapula province. My mother-in-law had gone out to do development work, age 60, in rural Kenya, and so we went and helped her with some Christian teaching from time to time. And then I got involved with Tanzania and led a number of missions to parts of Tanzania. My youngest daughter now is a missionary in Tanzania with a project which helps 100 handicapped people. And during that time, I wrote a few books, traveled to Argentina, Papua New Guinea as well. And one of the interesting things is the sort of experiences one was having with the evil powers were exactly the same in the most rural part of Zambia and the most sophisticated part of Oxford, because often people say it's only a cultural thing. Well, in fact, they behave in exactly the same way wherever you are.
Now, your theological training.
Yes. I'm about the most untrained person in the Church of England. Because I was in one of these independent boarding schools, I went to a very liberal theological college, and that didn't work out. And I then had a year with Michael Green in St. John's, Nottingham, an evangelical college. But I think I'm probably the least trained clergyman in the whole of the Church of England.
Interesting. Interesting. Now, does the Church of England in of itself embrace healing and deliverance? It seems that I've not seen much evidence of that in what we would call the Episcopal Church or the Anglican Church here in America.
I think it does embrace it in the sense that every diocese has a diocesan team. But if you go onto a diocesan website and try to find out where to get help, you're more likely to get lots of warnings about problems that may arise than you're actually be told who to go to. And that's actually one of the reasons why I've started publicizing what I've done a bit, because I feel the church needs to be much more upfront about it. It's very good news, and they need to be much more open. The only time I visited America, I have a friend who runs an evangelical Episcopalian church, which is fairly unusual, in a place called Paoli near Pennsylvania. And that's, I did a healing weekend there, and they're very much into that sort of stuff. But I think it's fairly rare in the Episcopalians in America.
John, as you were coming up and people were speaking into your life and talking to you and exposing you to various things, coming from a mathematics background, which puts you in the mindset of analytical, orderly, very much formula to do things in a particular order. As you multiply, divide, you have sets, you've got to put parentheses around the right things in order to get the right answer. How did all this fit in for you from a standpoint of processing it from an analytical, orderly mind? Did this seem logical to you?
It seemed completely logical to me once I was completely convinced of the truth of the resurrection of Jesus. Everything else seemed to fall logically into place. And actually, I found mathematics helpful. I've used some in the book, because if you take a very extreme example of an evil spirit speaking to me in Oxbridge English in a very rural Zambian village, this is a highly unlikely event, to put it mildly. But if you read the first chapters of Mark's Gospel, and if you say, well, if these are true, then an extraordinary event like I experienced in rural Zambia is possible. Whereas if the early chapters in Mark's Gospel are not true, there's no conceivable explanation. It's a thing called Bayes' theorem in mathematics, which I use a bit.
There's many arguments in the world today using a Socratic argument to look at the mathematical probabilities of prophetic fulfillment of the life and times of Jesus, the 28 prophecies alone fulfilled in the last week of his life, that the odds are statistically impossible. But they've also used these same odds for creation as they look at this randomness. If you say it's a random action, it would be like, I think they said, of taking the state of Texas, filling it up to a certain level with quarters, taking one quarter with a red mark on it and reaching into that entire stack, and the odds of you picking that one quarter from the very bottom, statistically and astronomically impossible, that would be the randomness of God or of a non-intelligent design or intelligent creator.
I think there have been a lot of arguments by intelligent physicists along those sort of lines. And I've certainly, just again looking at the resurrection, it seems to me there are so many strands of proof there, and the probability that they're all false is just incredible.
Well, you're exactly right. Now, I'm Jewish, so I was skeptical, of course, of anything to do with Jesus. The God of the Gentiles, the one in whose name our people were persecuted and found the compelling case was presented to me in the Old Testament, not in the New. The compelling case for the evidence of Jesus was too profound within the confines of a book that I would embrace as opposed to a book I would not embrace.
I think that's true of almost all Jewish people who come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah. It's always the Old Testament evidence that actually convinces them.
Yes, I mean, when you build a house, you build it on a foundation. The foundation of our life has always been the Torah, the writings, and the prophets. So if you, it's like building a house starting with the roof. It doesn't work.
Yes.
You've got to build up, to it. Now, you met your wife where and when?
I was teaching at Winchester, and the headmaster said, "You will write a religious drama." So I wrote a religious drama called The Life and Times of John Wesley. And I got to a moment in this where he says, "I went to convert the Indians, but who will convert me?" This was on one of his trips to America before he'd really experienced God. And I wrote to my mentor in Oxford and said, "I feel a bit like this." And he asked me to come on a Christian house party in the west of England, where a lot of students were going to be working for a week. And there I saw my wife, and I thought, she's the one. And we had one long conversation while we were there. And I worked out it would be 5 years before we were married because of various plans which she had. And we were married almost exactly 5 years after the first letter I wrote to her.
Now, wonderful. You know, you and I share something in common. I, too, am a graduate of Winchester, but I went to a prep school named Winchester.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
A fine name there and here in America. Your family background, when you began to embrace certainly the Church of England, but this particular aspect of the Church of England, how uniformly adopted is this within, let's call it, culturally acceptable?
I think that the healing ministry people are much more open to these days. Clergy are still quite frightened of it because they say, well, if it doesn't work, I shall get terrible flack. The deliverance ministry is much more controversial. So when I was made a prebendary of Wells Cathedral, one of the canons had just said he didn't believe in the devil. So I said I would preach about the devil. My first sermon in the cathedral, and I got into terrible trouble. And I was doing another conference in a cathedral, and an elderly clergyman stood up and said, "Isn't it time we stopped conniving with all this medieval mumbo jumbo?" And when I tell my African friends about this, they roar with laughter and say, "How could anyone be so stupid? It seems to them completely obvious that there is a spiritual opposition."
John, the oldest prophecy in the Bible, Genesis 3:15, clearly establishes what the world grabs a hold of. 2.5 billion Christians believe in the seed of the woman. But how do we get to the point where we reject the other half of the prophecy, which is indelibly linked to the first half of the prophecy, and that is the seed of the serpent? That is the Antichrist, that is the spawn of Satan, one who this fallen angel in the order of the Nephilim, all the angels who the sons of God mated with the daughters of men, and their offspring were such that how do we embrace half and deny the other half?
I think it's just because people find the idea of evil spirits and things quite incredible. And one of the things I say to people is just about half a mile from my house is there's a large park which used to be owned by the family of Lady Jane Grey, who was Queen of England for 8 days in 1553. And in that park there are a whole lot of snakes called adders, the only poisonous snake. But thousands and thousands of people walk through that park and they never see one. I quite often see them. I've even photographed them mating. But most of the people never see an adder, and so they probably don't believe there are any adders in the park. And I think that's very similar. People don't see any direct evidence although a surprising number of people, certainly in England, have had troubles in their houses and in their families and so forth, which are most naturally attributable to the power of the enemy.
We have become a society that looks at Scripture and sees that there's only three types of love clearly defined in Scripture: eros, pathos, and agape. But yet we have embraced over 2,800 names for phobias. There are phobias which are, there's a fear of phobias. There is a fear of peanut butter being stuck to the roof of your mouth. There's a fear of chickens. There's a fear of the most ridiculous things. And when I was leading the congregation, I printed out on a old dot matrix printer an entire ream of all of the phobias, and I laid them on the carpet before people got there. And so they had to walk on them. They had to put them under their feet. And I preached on that. And then they had to return to the altar to stomp on those fears until this paper was shredded, to understand the power of Luke 10:19. I've given you the authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing whatsoever shall harm you.
Yes.
And we've glorified fear. We've glorified Jack the Ripper. We've glorified Freddy Krueger. We've glorified evil. We've glorified Halloween. We've glorified the satanic. We've glorified the Phantom of the Opera, who is nothing but Satan himself, as the angel of the night. We've done all these things and yet deny that these homages which are paid to Satan all over the world. In Israel, we go to Pan's Temple. At Pan's Temple, and of course the name Pan is the root of panic and pandemonium and panacea and all those things. And of course Jesus stood there and said, "Today I stand at the gates of hell."
Yes, and that was where he declared himself as the Christ.
Yes.
Yes, I've been to that very, very place.
The very place. It does not change.
Yeah.
It does not
change. No, no.
And we know that the offerings that were brought to Pan, those sacrifices that were made there to this God who was half man, half goat, that these concepts of worship of things that are obviously not of God. Now, certainly we could say, well, maybe that was of God if we look at the duck-billed platypus, but God had never made somebody half man, half horse, or half goat. But this idea that we have now embraced these words in our language, and you and I both understand the power of words. We look at panic attack. We look at pandemonium. These are all tributes to Pan, the God the incarnate one who brings chaos and fear. God is not the author of fear. We embrace all those scriptures, but we don't acknowledge the present evil. And if we don't acknowledge the present evil, can we really understand the power and authority of faith in Jesus, of the very story of creation where the light overcame the dark?
Well, I don't think we can have an intelligent theology of God. It seems to me that, without wishing to be irreverent, you would say that God had done a very bad job in making the world in such a mess if there isn't some sort of spiritual opposition. But we do have to put this in perspective. Ultimately, it's all in God's control in the end, but he has given the opposing forces a great deal of freedom, and it really makes no sense to deny this. But the other side of it is, I think people find this stuff very attractive. I was trying to help a man the other day who was in Leicester Cathedral and was seeing all sorts of dead deans from the past and goodness knows what, and his mother was a spiritualist and we wanted to cut off the ancestral line. But in the end, he said no. He found this stuff too attractive, and he doesn't want to be free from it.
It is a common malady of man to become comfortable with their affliction. We have so many medications, so many prescriptions, so many diagnoses, so many maladies that affect them, and even to the point that you and I recognize them as spiritual. But what few people realize, John, is that fear is the point man for all other spirits. Fear is the gatekeeper, the door opener, the usher.
Yes.
And I can deal with your depression in a healing and deliverance service, and you will feel better. But if you don't bind the fear, if we don't close the door on fear, depression returns with seven of his friends. And
yes,
we begin to understand that we have to deal with the root and that's the fear.
Fear is a tremendous thing. Although there's an interesting concept in Mark's gospel, which is holy fear, which is where the disciples are in awe. And indeed, probably the authentic ending of Mark's gospel is with the ladies going to the tomb, and they were afraid, which sounds like a negative ending, but in fact, it's a very dramatic and positive ending to the gospel, because they were experiencing this holy awe.
Yes.
That the disciples, and that's the positive aspect of fear, which of course is quite
different from the sort of fears
that you've been talking about.
Yeah, reverence, humility, that awestruck, that no one comes into the Holy of Holies standing upright and proud. We come in, and the Hebrew concept is called shacha, to bow down low before the Lord. That we look at in the natural, you come into the presence of a king.
Yes.
What do? You kneel to one knee. You pay reverence by bowing your head. You greet a dignitary in Japan. You stand upright, but yet you bow before them with a reverent submission and acknowledgement of who you are in the presence of. We see it in the natural. We have to understand that in the supernatural, that God is truly calling us to bow before him in not surrender.
Yes.
Not surrender. No one's sticking a gun in your ribs and telling you to put your hands up to surrender. It is reverence and worship, which is the design of God for us to worship him and to come into an attitude of worship.
Yeah. And the fear that people with evil spirits display is quite dramatic. And you can see it in people's eyes and the very dramatic change when they're set free.
Yes.
And the fear in the spirits themselves, who know they're going to be sent to Jesus, and they don't look forward to that prospect.
Well, you are exactly right. It is a concept that people, they hear the words, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. They don't grab a hold of these very words, but they will quote them chapter and verse without any specific application in the kingdom.
That's right. It is extraordinary how people say they believe the whole of the Bible, but you get into this sort of stuff and they just want to deny it.
Is it because they're afraid, or is it because they're ill-informed?
I think it's mainly because they're ill-informed. I think they've been taught that this sort of thing was for the apostolic days only. One of my great heroes is St. Augustine of Hippo, and of course he said that all these spiritual gifts were unnecessary, the age of miracles was over. And then in his last book, he said, well, I've actually heard and seen 70 healing miracles in Hippo. And he describes one in enormous detail. So that right at the end of his life, this great founder of Reformed theology, really, changed his views on this whole matter, which is not generally taught.
You're exactly right. We're talking with John Woolmer from Leicester, England, author of The Devil Goes Missing, Deliverance, Theology, Practice, History. How refreshing, how powerful to hear a man of God from the Church of England who has fully embraced all over the world this incredible gift and power and authority we've been given through the shed blood of Jesus at his very spoken word when he gave us the authority we lost in the garden. But yet we named everything in the garden, which through the shed blood of Jesus he reestablished our dominion over everything that has a name. When we come back, we're going to explore this book with John Woolmer, a delightful conversation with a delightful man of God. We'll be right back.
This is Messianic Rabbi Eric Walker, Executive Director of Igniting a Nation Ministries, and your host for Revealing the Truth right here on the Igniting a Nation Broadcasting Network. I'm coming to you today with a very special offer from one of our very prominent guests, Dr. Carl Gallups. For your tax-deductible contribution of $30 or more, Pastor Carl Gallups will send you a signed copy of his new best-selling book, When the Lion Roars. In this book, you will discover what the Bible really says about the unprecedented demonic outpouring of the last days, the spirit of the days of Noah, the connection of technology and prophecy fulfillment, the spirit of Sodom and Gomorrah, apostasy in the last days church, why Turkey is central to last days prophecy, why Israel is the centerpiece of end time prophecy, the historical truth about Islam and ISIS, the Shemitah, the mystery of 666, and how Christians and the church should respond to these prophetic times. We are living in intense but exciting times. We're living in prophetically unprecedented times. Be on guard, prepare your heart and mind. Make certain you have a biblical balanced understanding of our generation. Be ready with wisdom and perspective. We have been raised up for such a time as this. The lion of God's prophetic word is roaring. Do you hear its call? Send your check payable to Igniting a Nation, 2700 Corporate Drive, Suite 120, Birmingham, Alabama, 35242.
Hi, I'm Angela Waite, and I just finished my interview on Revealing the Truth with Rabbi Eric Walker. I hope that in some way you will be touched by my story and that you will receive the healing you so desperately desire. I would like to share my story with you and send you a personalized signed copy of my book, Bomb Pops, Blow Dryers, and Butterfly Kisses, for your tax-deductible gift of $25 or more to Igniting a Nation, Inc. I will personally send you my book along with a note of encouragement as you take this journey with me. You will not only be supporting the work of Igniting a Nation, but all the proceeds that I receive from book sales goes to support Ramsey's Rescue, which targets the physical and spiritual care of the little ones who have been abandoned. It is the goal of this ministry to provide food, clothing, education, medical, a safe and loving home, and hope. Please help support both ministries with your gift and make a difference in so many lives today. Send your check payable to Igniting a Nation, 2700 Corporate Drive, Suite 120, Birmingham, Alabama, 35242. May the Lord bless you for your generosity and support.
This is the Reverend Rabbi Eric Walker, Executive Director of Igniting a Nation and host of Revealing the Truth, right here on the Igniting a Nation Broadcasting Network, inviting you to join me every Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday for our Prophecy in the News classes. Each week, I take the headlines from around the world that have a biblical connection and present them in a way that brings the news and the Bible to life. There are over 2,500 prophecies in the Bible, and there are so few classes available to see how they connect with world events. We cover everything from Islamic terrorism to the changing relationships between Russia, Turkey, Iran, Syria, and Israel. Prophecy is unfolding before our very eyes, and to many, it is complicated and hard to understand. In just 1 hour each week, you'll be given the tools and the biblical connection to world events. With so much going on, and so few reliable sources of news, I encourage you to join me every Monday night at 7 o'clock p.m. at St. Mark United Methodist Church in Northport, every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. at Beechwood Baptist Church in Mount Olive, and every Thursday night at 7 p.m. at Mountain Chapel United Methodist Church in Vestavia. If you want to make sense out of what's happened in the world around you, this is the class for you. All are welcome. Times and location addresses can be found on our website at ianbn.com. I hope to see you there. Shalom. Shalom and welcome back to this edition of Revealing the Truth, where we cover the headlines, the heart lines, and biblical truth. I'm your host, the Reverend Rabbi Eric Walker, and we are visiting with John Woolmer, author of the new book, The Devil Goes Missing, Deliverance, Theology, Practice, and History. John, welcome back to the program.
Thank you very much.
Well, you're very welcome. It's a delight to talk to you. You know, John, at break I told you that I've looked at my Bible and I could not find an expiration date, not at the end of any chapter, not at the end of the book, and not at the beginning of the book. That every word I believe that God has spoken is true, and that every bit of authority that we walk in, that we have through the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit, empowers us to be able to do marvelous and wonderful things in the kingdom to serve in that area. Now, you've devoted much of your ministry to deliverance, to healing and deliverance, and you've now shared with us in this book some of the theological considerations, some of the theological issues and challenges, references to the scripture and Satan, and the Bible coming to life in what we see is 2,000 years ago, but you assure us that this is relevant today. What are some of the theological challenges?
Well, I think first the challenge is to accept that the devil exists, that there is a spiritual opposition, which, as the great German theologian Oscar Kuhlmann says, the devil is held to a line, but it can grow so long that he can appear to act independently. I think the next challenge is to tell people that we can help them, and that these problems are not that unusual, whether it be in their family or in a building or a factory or a public house or whatever. And it's very important that the church proclaims this. I've known people who've gone off to spiritualists. They've paid several hundred dollars and their house has been in a worse state than before. And it's, I think, vital that the church proclaims this. It's wonderful evidence for the resurrection of Jesus. If I pray in a disturbed stable or a disturbed inn and the building is calm and people can sleep properly and all sorts of things, that can only be because Jesus is risen from the dead and these dark powers have been driven out. So I feel this is really good news. It's theologically vital because, after all, Jesus himself, it's central to his ministry, and he can't have got wrong on something as fundamental as that.
Well, no question. We often hear people say, he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Who do they think he who is in the world is?
I think if they think carefully, they realize that it's the power of the enemy. But probably they don't think too hard about that text. They probably just think about the first half, that he that is in us is powerful, and settle for that.
Right. And as you and I discussed, the Genesis 3:15 prophecy, we only grab a hold of the first part of it, the seed of the woman.
Absolutely.
Forgetting about the seed of the serpent.
Yeah.
The idea that Satan is an enemy has now been propagated to believe that Satan is an enemy of God. But in God's sovereignty, God has no enemies. Satan is a creation of God. God's dominion over Satan is clearly established in the book of Job, as we see that he has access to the throne, but not dominion over the throne. And he is an accuser of the brethren. Accuser of man. He is not an adversary of God. He lost his place because of his pride and arrogance, just as we too will lose our place for pride and arrogance. But he's not an enemy of God. He's an enemy of man. How do we get so confused?
Well, I think people's knowledge of theology is a bit limited, and certainly in England we tend to go along with very short sermons, and people don't like it if you go into these sort of areas. And I think C.S. Lewis in the Screwtape Letters said the devil's strategy was to lie hidden, and the biggest lie that the devil produces is that he doesn't exist.
Yes.
And I think most people can just about believe in God. They possibly believe in angels, but perhaps not. But the devil and evil spirits, well, that's just going a bit too far. And I think when I started out as a minister, I probably thought that, and it wasn't until I met it face to face that my views had to change.
In the book, you tell us about practical ministry in today's world. How can it happen? Generational healing, high places, haunted houses. Walk us through some of that.
Right. Well, generational healing is very, very interesting. Obviously, as you know, it comes in one sense from the Ten Commandments, but it also, I think, comes from John 9, where the disciples form up before Jesus with a blind man and said, who sinned, this man or his parents?
Right.
And Jesus didn't say, that's a stupid question. He said, on this occasion, this illness was for the glory of God. And I have seen occult stuff handed down through generations. I have a great friend who helps me with ministry. And when she was a little girl, she could see a black frame around people, and she knew they were going to die. And her mother was a spiritualist. She then became a Christian in her teenage, but she wasn't taught to renounce this, and she still saw it occasionally. She married a Christian man, and when he discovered this, he just cast it out from her. And she has an amazing gift now of helping people. But there are so many things that get handed down the generations. It's like DNA. We know so much about physical things and characteristics that are handed down, but so there are spiritual things. Freemasonry is another area that I've had to minister to a lot of people, and I've had 7 or 8 relatives of Freemasons, wives, daughters, grandchildren, who when I've started to pray have said, stop, there's a rope throttling me. And none of them knew that the first Masonic ritual was to be lined up and had a rope put round your neck and be blindfolded. And this generational stuff, I think, is something that we need to look into a great deal more than we do. As far as buildings are concerned, the first building I ever had to deal with was with a lady called Anne Good, and she lived next door to a very famous man in England called Mike Leavis, who runs the Glastonbury Pop Festival, which she didn't approve of at all. But anyway, she told me, my stables are haunted, I need them sorted. And I was extremely skeptical. I said, what's the evidence? And she said, oh, the horses go wild. And I said, well, my wife's horses go wild. But then she said there were pornography and that the previous owner's daughter, she thought, had done some very nasty things in the stables. Well, I stood outside the stables and blessed some water. This is an important part, I find, of the deliverance of buildings, because water is set aside, reminds the spirits of baptism, the cross, and the resurrection. It's not goo, it's actually rather good theology. And I threw some water in with a slightly iffy prayer, and there was a great whoosh, and a very tall, strong man beside me took several paces backwards as the force of what left the stables hit him. And again, you can't sort of put any psychological explanation to this sort of thing. We had a pub, a drinking place in Shepton Mallet called the Canard's Grave Inn. Not a very nice name. Canard was a highwayman, and his body was reputed to be under the bar. And the publican said, my children are having terrible nightmares. Will you come and pray? So we prayed in the house. Nothing obvious happened. One member of our team felt extreme cold. But 2 miracles occurred. The children's nightmares instantly stopped. And then the publican said, my son, aged about 4, has terrible eczema. We've tried every cure. Nobody can do anything. So 2 old ladies of our healing team went in to pray for the boy, and the eczema just went instantly. And so the cleansing of the building led to healing. And in Papua New Guinea, I was asked by an American friend to go to their house. They had a house in a village called Ukarumpa, which was a Christian village where all the Wycliffe Bible translators gathered. I'd been leading a conference. And their daughter, who I think it'd be polite to say was a pretty bolshy teenager, had said she'd had experiences of spirits in her house, in her bedroom, for 10 years. And her brother said the same thing. Now, the house was built in the side of a hill, and the children's bedrooms were actually sort of underground. But we prayed, and again, nothing very obvious happened. and the family went back to translate in their village. But they got an email from their daughter a few days later saying, I've now become a Christian and I'm going to get baptized in the river on Sunday. And she married another Christian boy from the Wycliffe family very soon afterwards. And that was a really dramatic change. And I tried to work out how a Christian household could have this problem. But I discovered that Ukarumpa was a place which two tribes had fought over for centuries. And the Australian government had given it to Wycliffe to solve the problem. And I think the house was built on a site of cannibalism. And there was some sort of very negative place memory which was affecting the children. But again, dramatic and positive outcome.
You know, John, as we listen to you describe this, I can envision some of our audience being skeptical about spirits attaching themselves to things. But yet, they would read in Acts chapter 19 that even the handkerchiefs and aprons that touched Paul were taken to the sick, and the diseases and evil spirits left them. That spirits do attach themselves to things, both positive. The anointing of the Holy Spirit can be.
Yes.
And the concept of the hem of the garment, this prayer shawl, this tallit, this fringe that Jesus would have been wearing, we tend to think it was on a cassock or it was the a beautifully sewn hem. It's fringe. Yeah. It's the fringe that we were commanded to wrap ourselves in the book of Numbers. And we realize that that which is in contact, this transference, does take place. That there was a movie years ago with Denzel Washington, and the spirits, upon touching one, would transfer from one person to the next as they moved through the community.
Yeah.
And it was quite an extraordinary movie. And there was a song, a whistling, that a man on death row who was put to death whistled before he died, and this kind of was the theme. And there are, as God told us, on Mount Ebal and Mount Gerizim, there are blessings and there are cursings.
Yeah, I think some people say, how can you believe in this sort of thing because it's not clearly in the Bible? But if you read, say, 2 Kings 23 and see the godly King Josiah defiling, that's the word used, and desecrating the places where Asherim and other Baals and all sorts of things have taken place. That is a sort of exorcism which Josiah was performing. And that's very similar to what we're actually called to do. But it was a huge surprise to me when I got into this ministry. It was about over 40 years ago. We went out to dinner with a retired headmaster, and there'd just been a very nasty case where a deliverance ministry had gone wrong in the Church of England, and I was sort of defending it theoretically. And when we got home, my wife was due to go into labor that night with our first child, and there was a couple on the door, as there often are on the door of Anglican clergy, and they said, we've come to complain about the social services. So I said, oh God, you better come in. After they'd been there about 5 minutes, she said, my problem's not the social services, I'm in league with the devil. So I said, oh, that's really interesting. Why don't you renounce the devil? And she screamed across the room that she renounced God and started walking around the room and talking like an old man, so much so that my wife thought there was a third person in the house. And she said, oh, your wife's going into labor tonight. And I said, no, she's not. You're lying in the name of the Lord. And our first child was born about 2 weeks late. And then I tried to get hold of my rector, and he was out with someone who wasn't on the phone, unbelievably. And she kept on saying, he's not coming, he's not coming. But about midnight, he turned up, and she was praying in demonic tongues, and he ordered me to pray. So I'd never prayed in tongues in public in my life, but this shut her up. And a few days later, a doctor said she had a personality disorder, which in psychiatric terms is incurable. And the diocesan exorcist came along, and he anointed her with oil, and she threw a cup of coffee over me, and you can still see the stains over Mark's gospel, where her coffee got a direct hit on the Bible. But she was very gradually healed and cured. A clergyman took her into a house, and 40 years on, she's living a reasonably normal life and is enormously grateful for the ministry she had. So that was a fairly dramatic baptism.
Yes, yes. You know, the first reference to demonic possession is in the Garden of Eden.
Mm.
Animals do not speak. God did not give the gift of speech to the animals. Otherwise, yes, he would have brought them to Adam to say, Adam, ask them their name.
Yep.
And they would have all spoken up. So Jesus...
You mentioned animals.
Yes.
Animals are incredibly sensitive, yes, to the power of darkness. And I've known houses where cats and dogs will not go into particular rooms and so forth because they sense something evil.
It's extraordinary what God has done. I think there's so much confusion. When Jesus said that he was the light of the world, this is a very specific reference to Genesis, when in the beginning God said, let there be light. He allowed the light to be perceived. The light already existed. He now...
Your mic is out. There it is.
The light from the darkness, and he called the light good. Jesus says, I am the light of the world. So we now begin to understand the frame of reference between light and dark, between good and evil,
yeah,
between the dominion, the light overcomes the darkness. We get all these references, but yet we want to state, well, we don't know when Satan fell. Well, we're given this, yeah, extraordinary picture of he fell in the beginning because we now know that darkness hovered over the deep. It was not in heaven, it was descended. Now it's waiting for light to come, it's waiting, yeah, for the earth to be formed so it may be dispatched to its Australia, the penal colony of England, of course, to the world itself.
but light is very interesting because you can see a darkness and a cloud in people's eyes when you pray for them.
Yes.
And three or four times I've had people who've complained that my eyes were burning them as I looked at them when they needed some sort of deliverance ministry. And after they were set free, they couldn't see the slightest problem. And Jesus said that the eye is the window of the soul. And so the light or lack of it in people's eyes, I think, is a very important diagnostic symptom.
Oh, you're exactly correct. There's a dark eyes, dark circles, a pallor, a certain pallor over them. I had a man bring his wife years ago who had been diagnosed with cancer, but what was going on with her was not the cancer. As a matter of fact, I never saw death on her. I saw her as oppressed as anybody I'd ever seen. But,
yeah,
but I asked her to sit down. And he said, why won't you pray for my wife? I said, because I want to deal with you. You're the,
yeah,
you're the carrier. You are the agent.
Right.
And if I,
yes,
don't, if I don't deal with you and get you clean,
right,
she cannot be healed. You are the darkness,
right,
encompassing her. You have been speaking death over her. You have been cursing her very existence. As opposed to cursing the cancer, you're cursing your wife. You are putting her in the grave, and I must take the spirit off of you. And he was very,
yeah,
resistant and very reluctant. And I said, you have the power of life and death over your wife right now. And unless,
yeah,
you surrender this, she will die. And,
yep,
he began to weep, yep, and he fell to his knees, and I laid my hands on him, and he shuddered, and he shook, and all of a sudden he opened his eyes, and they were clear. And I looked,
yep,
over at his,
yep,
wife, and she was smiling, and color was returning to her face,
yes,
and it was released, yep, off of her by him being delivered of it. And people have no comprehension of the strength and the power when you surrender. We know the,
yep,
power of Jesus and the power of God through the shed blood of Messiah, that if we surrender our life to him, that we get this new life. We forget that unless we take that authority over the darkness, that we're surrendering it to it as opposed to the light. And John, I know you've seen this many times. We've got about 4.5 minutes
yes.
left in this segment, and I want you to share some of the profound stories of your experiences, maybe one or two that come to mind over items, idols.
Well, I think one of the most dramatic was we were entertaining a psychiatrist and her husband to dinner, and a man knocked at the door, and he sat down silently. I knew him because I'd baptized his children. And after about 20 minutes, he said, "Could you go and see my wife? I've just beaten her up." So I cycled round, and she said, "Oh, don't worry. He's a binge drinker. This happens. Go back to your supper party." When I got back to my supper party, the dining room table was on its side. Our uninvited visitor was gnawing one of the legs. Four policemen were trying to hold him down. The psychiatrist and her husband were hiding in a cupboard. My wife was looking calm. The neighbor was looking rather perplexed. And eventually he calmed down, and I asked him if he'd been involved with Ouija boards, and he growled that he had in the Merchant Navy. And to cut a long story short, he started to come to church. The doctor dealt with his alcohol problem. But some months later, he said, "You know, I'm not free." And I said, "No, because we've never dealt with this problem." And he came out to my study, and he sat on a very strong chair that's still in my study. And he said, "You better pray quickly." And it split beneath him. And this 6.5-foot Marine was on the floor. And my rector was writing a book, I believe, in Satan's Downfall, a rather good book. My other colleagues were playing cricket, true English style. And I'm on my own. "In the name of Jesus, stop shaking," I said. And I was very glad when he did. And we drove through the Oxford rush hour traffic to find his Ouija board in his garden shed, which I had great difficulty destroying. And then we had a service where he renewed his vows of baptism. And when we got to "Do you renounce evil?" he started to shake, and I thought he was going to destroy all the pews in the church. And eventually he was able to say he renounced evil, and it was like a light coming on in his life. And that was very dramatic. Another person I was asked to visit, who was sitting in a downstairs toilet of a clergyman, hissing. So I waited for her to emerge, and I got her to renounce evil, and we seemed to make progress, and I saw quite a lot of her over the next year. But she said, "I've got this gift of tongues, I don't like it." So she came with a clergy friend, and I told her to speak out, and as she started to speak this tongue, she fell to the ground and started slithering across my study floor like a snake. She was delivered very quickly, and she's now in full-time ministry and a member of the diocesan deliverance teams and doing wonderful work. And it is so exciting to see this transformation. I mean, the Gadarene demoniac was clothed in his right mind, and that's the really good news, not the stuff about the pigs, not even his deliverance, but the fact that he became a faithful disciple.
Yes.
And that's what really excites me, because it's a tremendous evangelistic opportunity, all this sort of stuff.
You know, the people that struggle, I've had people say to me, "Well, I don't need deliverance, I do self-deliverance." Can someone do self-deliverance?
No. We are the body of Christ. It's almost impossible to pray for healing for oneself. We need other people to come and pray for us. James says, call for the elders of the church.
Yes.
And that's why we have a church. That's why we have the body of Christ. And self-deliverance is just self-delusion, in my view.
Well, that's the demonic part of you speaking to say, "Look, I don't need help.
Yeah.
I can help myself."
Absolutely.
And that's a telltale sign. We've been talking with John Woolmer, a delightful, spirit-filled conversation with an Anglican priest who believes in the power of healing, the power of deliverance, the power of the Holy Spirit, who has demonstrated in this book a comprehensive how-to guide for those involved in the ministry of deliverance, covering theology, practice, history, a balanced treatment of something that's often sensationalized. He takes this very seriously, as do I, And I have a tremendous amount of respect for this book and the work of John Woolmer, The Devil Goes Missing, Deliverance, Theology, Practice, and History. Visit the IgnitingANation.com website. Go to Books and Media. Click on this book. Get it for yourself. Get it for anybody involved in the deliverance ministry as a gift to them. This will be a handbook, a compendium for all that they've learned. They'll hear and see a new dimension to this as playing out right now on the shores of the newly Brexited England. And we thank you so much, John, for being with us. God bless you, my friend.
Thank you very much, Pastor.
Thank you.
God bless.
Enjoyed it. Thank you so much. And that concludes our broadcast day here on the Igniting Nation Broadcasting Network. We will be replaying these programs 24/7, 7 days a week. You can watch us and follow us on Facebook, on Twitter, on Instagram, and on YouTube, all at Igniting a Nation. Until we see you back here tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock Central Time, we wish you shalom.